This is going to be cells and tissues, but today we are only going to focus on only cells. And then we will do tissues either, we'll finish up later today or tomorrow, right? But I don't think later today will work, guys. You already, you have to attend this, and then we have biology at half past one. So it won't be fair. So I think tomorrow we'll do, right? And I don't want this session to be too long again, because you also have to attend biology, so I understand. Just to keep your brain active. So maybe it will be for an hour or so, because you know that after 40 minutes, it cuts us. So maybe we take these 40 minutes and then the next, and then I think we'll be done, right? I don't want to give you too much information, guys, because you're also humans. You also have to rest. So the video might be uploaded on my YouTube channel, might. So there's a possibility that I might not upload it, because I'm not really, I'm too focused on my YouTube channel, right? It will grow when, it will grow with time. So I'm just using it so that I don't keep on giving you permission when I'm sending you Google Drive and everything. But if it's on YouTube, you can access it anytime you want to. You can download it there if you want to. You can save it. You can do whatever you want to do with it. So hence, I upload the videos on my YouTube channel. But bear in mind that I'm only doing this for this week, right? Meaning that from after this week of this trial, from there, when others pay, I won't be uploading anything on YouTube, because it will be unfair to those who will be paid. So what I'll be doing, just giving you a tease video on YouTube, like, yeah, like what you're missing and stuff, right? So let's not waste time, guys. Let's not waste time. Let's go straight into it. So one thing you have to know before you can even start is that this chapter of cells and tissues, it's a lot, right? A lot, and it is a lot of terms and concepts and things that you have to remember. But the easiest way to remember everything is to repeat, right? Repeat and repeat and repeat, and then you'll be fine. It's a very, very basic chapter, because without this, your anatomy isn't, you won't understand anatomy at all, because this is the basic of each and every system, right? So as I said, we're only going to focus on cells. So the first thing that you have to know is what we call the study of cells, right? The study of cells is called cytology. So meaning that today we are only going to focus on cytology, and then we will do the study of tissues, which is called histology, tomorrow, right? And then hopefully we finish with tissues tomorrow, and then the next day maybe we do a review, depending on whether you guys did understand everything or you want me to elaborate on some of the things, right? Because I said at least by the end of this week, if we can do three chapters, right? So this is our second chapter. So if we can do the third one, I'll be glad that I managed to help where I can for those who can be continuing with me, right? So with that being said, guys, one thing that you have to know from the cytology, it's, as I said, it's a lot, right? But I'll break it down for you. You have to know, let me start with just a quick history of the cells and everything. But what is important with the history, because the history is so long and a lot of things happened, right? I just want you to know the name of this guy, because he's the one who discovered the cells, right? I'm sorry for the background noise. You have to know Robert Hooke, right? They will ask you about him. Don't worry about the other guys. This is not biology, right? With biology, they will ask you about the other guys and everything. This is anatomy. You don't have to worry much, right? So just know this guy, Robert Hooke, that he's the one who discovered the cells in, I think it was 1655, if I'm not mistaken, right? So the year is not important in anatomy, right? Because in anatomy, you can say 1600s, right? But to be specific, it was 1655 when he discovered the cell. He was looking under the microscope, he was looking at the plant tissue of a cork plant, of a cork tree, right? If you, maybe when you have time, just go on Google and then type cork plant, you'll see that tree, right? So he just looked at that tissue under the microscope, then he discovered some cube-shaped structures under the microscope, because that tissue, the cells were dead at that time. When he was looking under the microscope, they were dead. So all was left, what you could see was only the cell wall. So the cell wall was the only thing that was left, right? And he didn't know. Remember, at that time, this weird cell wasn't even there. So he was just okay, these things to him, they seemed like homes. You can see how their shape. They seemed like smaller rooms. So he thought of the rooms he used to see at the, you know, monks, right? So I don't know whether he was a monk or he was staying with monks or whatever. So he thought of those rooms at the monarchy, right? So he was like, okay, these are like the rooms. And those rooms at the monarchy, they used to call them cells because they would breathe and everything. So he called these cells, right? Not to say cells. And then that word has been, and these structures have been called cells ever since. To this day, they are called cells because of Robert Hooke called them cells, right? So that is just the history that you have to know, right? And then after that, after Robert Hooke, they made more discoveries and everything. Like some others made discoveries that they are organelles, like this is a cell membrane and everything. That's just too much, right? What I want you to know is that Robert Hooke is the one who discovered cells in 1655. That is what I want you to know. The rest, just forget about it, right? And then after some time, around the 1800s, right, somewhere there, around the 1800s, you must just imagine from 1655 to 1800s, obviously they've made a lot of discoveries about cells and everything. And around the 1800s, that is where they got a clear picture of what cells look like what's their function and everything, right? So another thing that you have to know about cells is that they're the structural and functional unit of living organisms, right? They are the structural and functional unit of living organisms. Back at high school, if someone was to ask you what is a cell, the simplest definition you would give that person is what cell is a basic unit of life, right? But right now, yes, it is a basic unit of life. But right now we are explaining it even further to say that it is a structural and functional unit. Because when I'm talking about the structural and functional unit, then we have to mention something that you have to know. The moment you speak about structure and function, right? Your structure, remember, it's your anatomy, right? I'll just write ANA. Your structure is your anatomy. Function, that's your physiology, right? So meaning that, in simplest terms, you wouldn't have your physiology. Your physiology is dependent on what? On structure. Your structure dictates, or it identifies what the function of that particular cell will be, right? A cell that has a bigger surface area and a cell that has a smaller surface area won't have the same function. A cell that has a particular shape, right? And a cell that has more mitochondria, a cell that has more endoplasmic reticulum, a cell that has a cell wall, a cell that has more peroxisomes and everything, all those cells will have different functions based on their structure and based on what they have. I hope I'm making sense, right? So from this saying that the physiology is determined by the structure, we get what we call the principle of complementarity, right? Let me just write it down, guys. This, they will ask you, right? Principle of complementarity. I hope you can see it is the size, or should I? Yeah, principle of complementarity. So they want, maybe they might ask you what it states, right? But with anatomy, you know, for you guys, it's just multiple choice, right? So the principle of complementarity just tells you that the structure defines the physiology. Bali, your hand is raised.
No, sorry.
Okay. So do you understand what the principle of complementarity is, guys? Principle of complementarity states that the structure defines the function of that particular cell or organ or whatever. Are we clear?
Yes.
That's good. So, and then after they've made all those discoveries and everything, they came with something that they called cell theory, right? So cell theory was just to summarize the discoveries that they made. Kitumitz is saying I must repeat. What is it that I must repeat, Kitumitz? I should repeat what the principle of complementarity is, or I should repeat because I've said a lot of things. If you want me to repeat the principle of complementarity, I'm saying that the principle of complementarity is stating that the structure, in this case, the structure of the cell will determine the function of that cell, right? What do we mean by structure? By structure, we mean the anatomy of the cell. How is the cell looking like? What does the cell have, right? Does the cell have the same membrane? Does it have a cell wall? Does it have more mitochondria? Does it have less endoplasmic reticulum? What does the cell have? And the reason behind why it has that, right? So if it has, like, for example, it has more mitochondria, we know that mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell, right? It is the one which gives energy. So it means that if that particular cell has more mitochondria, it means that particular cell will have something to do with providing energy for the rest of the body. Do you get me?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. So that is basically the principle of complementarity. It states that the structure defines the function. It can be the structure of a cell, it can be the structure of the organ, we don't care. Right? The structure of something defines its function. Just like the integumentary system we just did now. The structure of those layers, right? They define or they give the function of the skin, which is protectivity, right? There's no such word. Protection, right? Like, it explains why we say the skin is protecting us. Those layers, right? Because we can't say that the skin is protecting us based on if it only has one layer, right? So the multiple layers it has, and for the mere fact that we had melanocytes, the structure of the melanocytes and everything, that describes why we have different colors. That is all just the principle of complementarity, anatomy and physiology, right? The physiology depends on anatomy, right? How is the anatomy? You get me? Are you now fine, Kitumitz? Do you understand? Others, do you understand?
Yes.
Okay, good, guys. We must work on time. Okay, I'm glad. So, you will understand. As I just said that after from 1655 to 1800, they made a lot of discoveries, right? And then they came and they said, okay, I'm going to do that. Mbani and Kanye, please move your mic. Kanye, mute your mic, please. Thank you. And yeah, so they summarized all of the discoveries they made, and they called that what? Cell theory. A lot of textbooks have different ways of stating this, but it all comes to only four things that you have to know about the cell theory, right? To give you the simplest ones, number one is that what they discovered is that all organisms are made up of cells, right? I don't know if you want me to write that down. All organisms are made up of cells, right? That's number one. All organisms are made up of cells, right? All organisms are made up of cells. That is number one. Let me write it down for you guys. And then the second one that you something that they also discovered was that new cells are formed from the pre-existing cells, right? So new cells, I'll just say new cells are formed from old cells. No, they are formed from pre-existing. And then the third thing that you have to know, what they also discovered was that all cells are similar, right? And most of the textbooks, the word they use for this third point that all cells are similar, they use the concept of a generalized cell. So if you see, generalized cell, it simply means that all cells are similar. So they've just generalized all cells by one cell. Because if you go to the internet, you search, or you go to any textbook, and then you see the picture of a cell, they've just shown you one cell, whereas we have trillions of cells. Humans have 50 to 100 trillions of cells in their body, and we have about 200 types of those different cells. But we can't show you all those 200 types of cells and all those 50 trillion cells for you to understand what a cell is. So we just show you one cell which generalizes all the cells. So that is what they mean by all cells are similar. They are not the same. They are similar, right? And then one last thing that they discovered about cells is that the continuity of life has a cellular basis. So what does continuity of life, what does this statement of continuity of life has cellular basis, what does it mean? So it simply means that whether as much as we have different living organisms, as much as we have humans and other animals and everything, but it all comes back to cells. The reason why we are different, the reason why we had apes, the reason why we have monkeys and everything, it's because of cells. So the cells, the reason why we are different, and the reason why we continue to have other species and why do I forget such? I'll remember it, guys. But what I'm saying is that the reason why we continue evolving, right, is because of sense. When some change happens in our cell, it will change the whole organism, right? Or it will impact some cells. Then those cells, because same a group of cells performing the same function from tissues, right? So imagine if that group of cells, they have a certain change, right? So they will affect the tissue. There will be a change in the tissue. And when the tissue changes, that will also change the organ, right? When the organ changes, that will change the system. When the system changes, you get me. So that is why we say that the change, right? The bigger picture that we see, or the change, the great change that we see, it all goes back to the cells. Meaning that before that big change happened, it first happened where? At the cellular level. So that is what we mean by the continuity of life, having cellular basis, right? Do you understand me? I'm having connection problems and it's very difficult to hear you. What are you saying? Nakisani, I'm saying that the continuity, this statement of continuity of life, having cellular basis, it simply means that when there is a change at the cellular level, that will impact the overall structure of the organism in simplest terms. Do you guys understand me? So all these 4 points is your cell theory. And again, I'll repeat, not all textbooks will use the exact same words, right? It will be different words, but it all comes to the same explanation. Are we clear? Do you understand me, guys? Do you understand me? Why do you guys prefer typing rather than speaking to me? Okay, so what next? Something that you also have to understand is that all cells, this is not part of the cell theory, right? This is all cell theory. This is all cell theory. What you have to understand is that all cells have these four elements. You have to know these four elements, right? They are also called the major elements of a living organism. Why they are called the major elements of a living organism? Because they are the four elements that make up a cell, right? So these four elements, it's your carbon dioxide, right? It's your hydrogen, it's your oxygen, and your nitrogen. These are the four elements that you have to know. They constitute 96%, if I'm not mistaken, of the human body of, right? The other four remaining percent is other elements. But what you must understand is these four main ones. So basically, if you have a damaged cell, then the rest of the new cells will have the same deficiency. Not really, Mbali. It's like, let me say, the great example I can give you is in the case of cancer, right? And when your cancer is now malignant, right? When it now it can go to other areas of your body. It can go there, right? If it's not treated at an earlier stage. So meaning that if we were to leave that cell, if you didn't go to see a doctor or something, that would change the like your body as a whole, because the tumor will be everywhere, right? So meaning that for whatever disease, if it's not treated at an early stage, those impacted cells can affect other nearby cells. I don't know if I'm making sense. Like, if you have skin cancer, right? And let's assume that it's only around your left arm. It's only in your left arm, right? Let's say you have melanoma, right? It's only in your left arm. If that melanoma is not treated at an early stage, it can then metastasize to other regions of your body. I don't know if I'm making sense. Guys, we are left with 10 minutes. So after 10 minutes, you must come back, because this is just the introduction. After 10 minutes, you must come back. Click the same link I sent on the group chat and come back immediately. I won't tell you to come back. You know what to do. So far, do you guys understand me? Okay, I'm glad you got it. So this is what I want to explain before this session even ends. Let me quickly explain this. Basically, guys, your cell only has, if we can break it down, your cell only has three parts or three regions, right? Your cell has a cell membrane, also called plasma membrane, right? Your cell has a cell membrane, it has your nucleus, and it has your cytoplasm, right? Those are the simplest, or those are the main regions of the cell. These three, so nucleus, and everything that is in the cell, everything you see in the cell, it's either it occurs in one of these, right? So every cell, we expect it, every eukaryotic cell, because I mean, this is anatomy, we are speaking about living things. So we don't bother about the prokaryotic cell, right? So every eukaryotic cell, in this case, it's us humans. In anatomy, we don't bother about other things. In biology, you will, right? But in this case, we are only on humans. So every human cell has a cell membrane, has a nucleus, and it has a cytoplasm. Remember when we were doing the integumentary system, we said that cells undergo apoptosis, right? Which is programmed cell death. That is when they lose the nucleus. Why is it that when a cell loses its nucleus, it dies? That is because the nucleus contains what? The genetic material, right? It contains the genetic material, it contains your DNA. Let me write that clean. Contains your DNA. And your DNA contains instructions to build the whole body. So without the nucleus, it means that there's no DNA. And without the DNA, it means that cell doesn't have instructions as to what it should do, right? So that cell is useless. And you know, obviously, that your DNA has what? It has genes. Guys, I hope you're writing these things down, because I won't write everything down. I won't write everything I'm saying down. So if you're lucky, if I record this session and then upload it in my YouTube channel, you can go back and view it and watch it as many times as you want to, if and only if you didn't understand. Because repetition is key. The more you repeat, the more you will get it, and it will get stuck in your mind, right? So it also has genes, and your genes contain instructions to build proteins. So your DNA contains instructions to what? To build the body. But it can't do that because that's just, it's a massive, massive activity for it alone, right? So you know that your DNA has what? Genes. So your genes contain instructions to build what? To build proteins. So automatically all of these proteins will join and ultimately they will control and build up structures for the whole body. And one other thing that you have to know about the nucleus is that it doesn't have a specific shape, right? Some like saying the nucleus is circular shape. It doesn't have a specific shape. It conforms to the shape of the cell, right? It doesn't have a specific shape. It conforms to the shape of the cell. So if the cell is oval, the nucleus will be oval. If the cell is circular, the nucleus will be circular, right? So it conforms to the shape of that particular cell. I hope we are on the same page. But before we can even go there, now that you understand that these are the basic parts of each and every cell, that your cell has a cell membrane. And when we are speaking about the cell membrane, we should discuss two things. When you're speaking about the cell membrane, we should discuss two things. You must understand the cell membrane, you must understand the junctions. Not all. It will kick you out, right? Because I can see that you just joined. It will kick you out in no time. Not only just you, but everyone, guys. We are left with 3 minutes. So after 3 minutes, it will automatically kick us out. And then you must come back immediately. Come back, go to the group, click that link and come back, right? So your cell membrane will discuss the junctions. We will also discuss the fluid mosaic model, right? The fluid mosaic model. I won't write fluid mosaic model. Let me just write mosaic. Mosaic is just an fancy way of saying pretty, right? Don't be confused. Let me include fluid, it's okay. So this two, the fluid mosaic model and your junctions, they are on your cell membrane. They have to do with your cell membrane, right? We will discuss the junctions, and then we will also discuss the fluid mosaic model as well, right? I hope you're on the same page. And then on your nucleus, what we will discuss, we will talk about the chromatin. Okay, guys, hence I'm saying you must write these things down, because by the time I finish, it will be messy, right? The screen will be messy. Kanye, are you writing down notes? Because I'm just seeing your face. I'm not seeing any book. So your nucleus, we'll talk about the chromatin network. I'll just write chromatin, right? In your nucleus, when we're discussing the nucleus, we'll talk about the chromatin network. Let me just, okay. Meaning that after this session, because we are left with 1 minute and a few seconds, after this session, the first thing that I will do when we start with the next session, right? I will discuss the chromatin network, and then I will also discuss, we'll talk about the nucleolus, because all of these things, the chromatin network, the nucleolus, and the nucleopore, they all have to do with your nucleus. I hope I'm not confusing you guys so far. If I am, please tell me. I don't want to make things difficult for you. I'm here to try and simplify everything for you. Nucleopore. we are left with less than a minute. So if it kicks you out, please come back. Right? If it kicks you out, please come back. We will have the same screen when we come back, right? And then we can continue from there. So I repeat, guys, it will kick you out. Please click the link and come back. Did you understand everything on this session?
Yes.
Okay. This is just an introduction. We haven't even started.
Wait. Under